Matthew chapter 8 is where we find ourselves tonight. And when he, that is Jesus, came down from the mountain, that is the Mount of Beatitudes, great multitudes followed him. Remember, he preached his sermon, declared his teaching to the disciples, but his eyes were on the multitude. And so this multitude, great multitude, continued to follow him. And behold, a leper came and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. Leprosy was the dreaded disease of the ancient world. I mean, you got leprosy, that was it. It was the incurable disease. And it was just a matter of time before you died. Luke, in his gospel, declares that this leper was full of leprosy. He's in the later stages of it. And so probably his fingers and his toes and his nose and his ears gone now and this kind of thing. He is desperate among the desperate. And he's got this leprosy and this incurable disease. And one of the fascinating things in the New Testament in the treatment of the subject of leprosy is that you find that when God touches a body with leprosy, it's never referred to as a healing, it's referred to as a cleansing. It's a physical malady that they have. Just like the paralysis that's going to be healed in the next passage that we look at, you would think that he healed this man of his leprosy, but it's not. Always was referred to as a leper being cleansed of his leprosy. And the reason is because leprosy from one end of the Bible to the other is a picture of sin. It's a picture of sin. And leprosy needed to be cleansed from a person's life, just as sin needs to be cleansed from our life. And so leprosy was incurable. Nobody really knew how it was transmitted, you know, from one person to another. They knew that it was transmitted, but there was no way of knowing how it was transmitted. We don't know how sin is transmitted from one person to another, from one generation to the other. We know that it had its origin in Adam and Eve, but we don't know how it moves on from us into our children. We just know when they're born, they're sinners. They're little lepers. They're little sinners. We don't have to, you know, to train them to run away from us or to throw a temper tantrum or these things. It comes natural to them. And so leprosy, the beautiful thing about leprosy is it's a picture of sin. And so when we see the leper being healed, there is a beautiful type of us being healed of our sin, or rather not being healed, of being cleansed of our sin. And you notice that as he comes to Jesus, he said, Lord, if you're willing, you can make me clean. Now, a leper was never to come within 100 feet of a healthy person. And whenever someone got within 100 feet and sometimes as far as 150 yards, depending on the wind, they were supposed to cry out, unclean, unclean leper, to let people know that there was a leper around so that people would stay away from it because nobody wanted to get leprosy. And yet here's a man, there's a great multitude around. He just said, I don't care, what do I got to lose? I'm getting to this guy. And he violates the 100-yard law. And he gets to Jesus because he's desperate, related to his need. And notice what Jesus said. You disgusting excuse for a human being. That's not what he said. That is what the teaching of the rabbis of the day was. They looked at it and they said, the reason any person was a leper was it was the hand of God against him. The beautiful thing is you look right here in verse 3, that wasn't what was going on at all. The hand of God is going to touch him and cleanse him. And the Lord put out his hand and he touched him. This man had never been touched by a clean person, a non-leprous person, since the time he had his leprosy. His only contact was with other lepers. He's in a world of his own. And never dreamed, I mean, he hoped to be cleansed, but never dreamed that Jesus would touch him. It's amazing who God is willing to come into contact with and who he's willing not only to touch us. Wasn't it great that when we came to the Lord, he didn't pull back, you know, it with revulsion or horror? Oh, no, not you. Wouldn't it have been something you come with all of the need, all of the desperation, all of that, and you find out that, you know, this was really for everybody else. But when we came to him, I mean, how he took us to himself, how he was willing not only to touch us, not only to cleanse us and forgive us, but more than touch us, to come inside of us and indwell us. These are awesome symbols, this bread and this cup, of a life, God in human flesh, willing to have that kind of contact with us. And so Jesus is this man. He knows that Jesus can cleanse him. His question is whether Jesus would cleanse him. And Jesus put out his hand and touched him and said, I'm willing, be cleansed. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus said to him, see that you tell no one, but go your way, show yourself to the priest and offer the gift that Moses commanded as a testimony to them. And so in the Old Testament, in Leviticus chapter 14, there was a law that was laid out in God's precious word. You know, I mean, you look at the Bible and it looks like a pretty good-sized book. But when you think about what God could have put in it, we would all need to drive trucks to church in order to unload our Bible. And I mean, every page, every single thing is valuable. And here he is. He puts a ceremony in the Old Testament law for that was to be performed by the priest for the leper in the day of his cleansing. A ceremony, a rite to be performed for the leper in the day of his cleansing. And you read the entire Old Testament and there's only two people that get cleansed of their leprosy. Miriam, the only Jew that was, the sister of Moses, and then Naaman, the Syrian. Only those two people were cleansed of their leprosy. And yet here God included this rite, this ceremony that the priests were to go through in the day of the cleansing of a leper. And that rite stayed on the books for the day that God knew he was going to send his only begotten son in this world and that Jesus was going to send a stream of cleansed lepers towards those priests. And every time they turned around, here they are is another cleansed leper coming to the temple saying, listen, I need that rite that was going to be performed in the day of the cleansing of a leper. I've been cleansed. They'd search him for the sores. They'd search him for the scabs. They'd search him for the discoloration of the hair to make sure that they were cleansed. And believe me, when these lepers began to make their way to the temple for that ordinance that was in Leviticus chapter 14, those priests had to look it up. They hadn't done that in hundreds and hundreds of years. Nobody even knew what the thing was for. And every leper that Jesus sent to those priests was a communication to those priests that the Messiah is here. The Messiah is on, you know, on the earth. The Messiah is, according to the scriptures, is in place. And he is the one that is sending this stream of cleansed lepers your way. It's interesting that when Jesus finishes his Sermon on the Mount, you know, I mean, the teachers and philosophers have always been a dime a dozen. And they are even to this day. But someone who can back their words up. We got enough words in the world. I mean, that television has 197 stations. And how much can you talk about Elian? Whatever you feel about the position. I mean, how many hours, how many cumulative hours, eternal, I mean, precious, finite hours spent just talking and talking and talking, these talking heads all over the place. And Jesus wasn't just one to come along and just do more talking. He could back it up. And that's what chapters 8 and 9 are all about. He comes on the scene and he says, listen, I didn't just come to talk. I've got authority behind what I'm saying. And I'm going to show you that I do have authority. And every bit of authority that I express here in contact with mankind is to communicate to everyone that the Messiah just showed up. The Messiah is here. It's not like this stuff was happening every day before Jesus came. God hadn't even spoken to the children of Israel by word through prophecy for 400 years before the time of John the Baptist. And so it was just like heaven had been torn open with what was happening here. And all of it a demonstration that Messiah had come. The Messiah was here. And then Jesus, he speaks to them in verse 4 and he tells them, other than the priest, be sure not to tell anyone. Now that's a hard command. Don't tell anyone about it. Well, I don't know. We don't know if they obeyed or not. Just about everyone else disobeys that command, you know, because of what the Lord had done. It's a tremendous thing, and we want to let everyone know. If you're here tonight, and you're hopeless in your sin, everyone you hang around is afflicted with the same sin and the same life-dominating sin as you are. And you have never known what a normal life is. Isn't it sad the way the world is today? You have these kids growing up, they've never seen two normal human beings in their household. All the drugs going on, all the different things going on, all the things that they're exposed to. Then they just grow right up, and they just follow in the ranks. There's something weird about being a kid, you know, as perverse and as wicked as things may be, when they're a part of your life at formative times in your years, in your life, they constitute a comfort zone. They get a place. And then all of a sudden this thing is just tracking generationally within families. And pretty soon I can look and say, there is no way I can ever be taken out of this. There's no way that I can ever be changed. I could never be cleansed. I could never be made a different person and a new person. And the Lord Jesus can do it in your life tonight. And He's willing to do it. I don't care what you've seen. I don't care what you've done. I don't care what you've been in the middle of. I don't care how unclean your uncleanness is. He will touch you Himself tonight. And He will come inside of your life and live inside of your life and make you into something altogether different. There's hope for you. And the only reason there's hope in this world is because of the presence of the Lord Jesus by His Holy Spirit. There's not a hopeless case in this world. Hopeless, impossible in the strength of man. And that's why we have to be careful not to carry these tutti-frutti ideas that we come up with, that we call wisdom, and we want to give people instead of the Word of God and instead of pointing them to God. There's only one hope for mankind in this world, and that is a personal encounter with the true and the living God who loves us and has the ability to cleanse us and to change us. And He'll do that. And He'll do that in your life tonight. There's hope for you. And then He goes on and He describes not only His authority over leprosy, but then His authority over paralysis. Now, when Jesus had entered Capernaum, which is on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, beautiful part of Jerusalem, of Israel, when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion, that is a Gentile, this is a Gentile now, and he's a Roman Gentile over in the Roman military, over 100 soldiers. That's what his authority was. He came to Jesus pleading with Him. Here's another desperate situation, saying, Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed and dreadfully tormented. Jesus' authority over paralysis. And Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. And here this Roman centurion never dreamed that Jesus would come to his house. Never dreamed that Jesus would walk with him to his house to give personal attention to this servant within his house. And Jesus comes and says, sure, I'll come along with you. And the centurion answers, I mean, it's almost too much for him. And he said, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof. Only speak a word and my servant will be healed. This is an extraordinary man, this centurion. Because at this time in ancient history, in the Roman Empire, there were over 6 million slaves. Slaves were property. They were nothing. You could starve them. You could work them to death. You could do whatever you wanted to them. And when that one died, you just went down to the plaza and you bought another. The babies were laid out and abandoned all of the time, all over the place, raised up by these people, sold as slaves later and all. Slaves were cheap. And here's a man who's got a slave who's paralyzed, and he's concerned for the slave. This is a pretty special guy. Doesn't just look at humanity and says, yeah, it's a dime a dozen. You know, that one goes. I'll just grab myself another one. He's concerned about his servant. And what does he do with his concern? He brings, by way of intercession, he brings the need of his servant to the Lord Jesus. And so he's a man of compassion, and he brings that need to Jesus. And then when Jesus says, I'm going to come, he says, listen, you don't come. Only speak a word and my servant will be healed. And then verse 9, here's the real mind blower of all. For he says to Jesus, for I also, Jesus, you and me are alike. I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this, and he does it. And what he's saying to Jesus is this: Jesus, I understand authority. I know how it works. The whole Roman Empire operates on the basis of authority. Jesus, I have 100 men who are under my authority. And when I tell them to go, they go. And when I tell them to come, they come. And Jesus, I know that what is true concerning me about 100 men is true concerning you over all of creation. When you say go, it goes. When you say come, it comes. In the realm that is seen and the realm that is unseen. Jesus, I recognize you have all authority. You don't have to come to my place. You can handle this from a long distance. It's all under your control. You just speak the word and it happens. And that's a fabulous thing to realize, that all of this is under Jesus' control. He just speaks the word and then everything starts, you know, to pop as it relates to all of that. And Jesus, interesting, his reaction to all of this, when Jesus heard it in verse 10, he marveled and said to those who followed, assuredly, he turns now to the crowd and he begins to preach to them based on this man's faith, assuredly, I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. And here is Jesus marveling. It's one of only two times in the New Testament that he marvels over someone's faith. And this time, he marvels over a Gentile's faith. He said, I haven't even found this faith among the Jews, the people that ought to have had it. And then he goes on and he says in verse 11, and I say to you that many will come from east and west, speaking of the Gentiles, and sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the sons of the kingdom, that is the Jews, the physical Jews, will be cast out into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. They were trusting in the fact that they were physical Jews, but they were not spiritual Jews. They weren't trusting in God, in His plan, and they certainly weren't trusting in the Lord Jesus, having faith and confidence in Him. And Jesus said, all of these guys that have all of these privileges, here they are. They've been raised in the Word. Do you know how many people would give their right arm to have been raised in the Word of God in their youth instead of what they were raised in? The enormous privilege of it, but there's a danger to it too, and that is to be raised all of my life around the things of God, and then they no longer impact me. And the things that ought to just really hit me hard, they hit a Gentile who has no background in spiritual things at all harder than they do me. And we have to be careful. It's a blessing and it's a privilege to be raised around the things of the Lord. But I can't fall asleep related to those things. I can't allow those things to lose their, just the awe related to them in my life. And it's possible to be raised in church all of my life around the things of God and never be born again. Never give my life to the Lord. Never long for the things that the Lord offers. And so here they are, all of these privileges, but they're going to miss out on heaven because they wouldn't take that step in trusting in the Lord. And then the Lord said to the centurion, verse 13, go your way, and as you have believed, so let it be done for you. And his servant was healed that same hour. And verse 14, now when Jesus had come into Peter's house, he saw his wife's mother lying sick with a fever. So here we're going to learn that Jesus has authority over mother-in-laws. And that's no easy thing, really, is it, on things. It's good to know that I have a mother-in-law. We don't call her mother-in-law. We call her affectionately Mimi. She gets the Sunday night tapes. We sure love Mimi. But anyway, but he comes into Peter's house. His mother-in-law is lying sick. She has a fever. Jesus touched her hand and the fever left her. And then she arose and she served them. This is totally weird to me. You've got someone who's been cleansed of leprosy. You got someone who's been healed of paralysis, and then we've got an account of Jesus healing someone of their fever. And I think the lesson is great because the lesson is this. There's nothing too small to bring to Him. There's nothing that He's not concerned about. And there's a great tendency to think, you know, listen, if I had leprosy, I'd have the elders anoint me with oil. If I had, there was paralysis or something like that, I would bring it to God. But I mean, I've just got a sore throat. Or I've just got a sprained ankle. I'm not going to trouble God with that. God's interested in all of it. He wants all of it to be lifted up to Him. And He's eager to touch us and to meet the needs within our lives. And so He takes, and when He touches her hand, she's healed, the fever leaves her, and then her response was she arose and she served them. And so she was healed, and she used her healing to then serve the Lord. A wonderful expression of gratitude. Now, it is important to note that Peter did have a mother-in-law. So if he was the first pope, the first pope was married. And I just lay it out for you to run out wherever you want. You know, we're going to hit a lot of this stuff as we go through the Gospels and all. We might as well just put it on the floor and think about it. It is also interesting that his mother-in-law didn't get upset with him, that he brought the Son of God home while she's sick in bed. What are you doing? I can't believe it. You didn't call. You're bringing the Son of God home. The place is a wreck. Look at me. You know, now she was very happy to have him there. And the Lord is comfortable, really, in any environment. But I'm not giving those of you who are sinfully messy about your house an excuse. But anyway, verse 16, we'll move on. And when evening had come, they brought to him many who were demon-possessed. And he cast out the spirits with a word. And he healed all who were sick, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, He himself took our infirmities, he bore our sicknesses. And so again, all of this testifying to the fact that Jesus was and is the Messiah, not simply because he declared himself to be, but because he was according to the scriptures. He fulfilled the Old Testament scriptures that spoke of the Messiah who was to come. Now, in verse 18, when Jesus saw great multitudes about him, he gave a command to depart to the other side. And then a certain scribe came and said to him, Teacher, I will follow you wherever you go. And so here we see Jesus' authority demonstrated in what he requires of his disciples. And he has the authority to require of his disciples what he wants to require, the cost of discipleship. A scribe was kind of an expert in the law in those days. It was kind of a flattering thing to have a scribe come to you and say, listen, I want you to be my rabbi. I want you to teach me. Jesus could have looked and said, all right, now we're getting somewhere. I got a bunch of fishermen and, you know, I know I'm going to get stuck with a tax collector and all. I'm working with some riffraff here. I'm finally going to get some good stuff, you know, good Tom Hinman in here. And there's like, Tom, I looked at you. I'm sorry. I got to work you into every sermon somewhere. But anyway, so here is this guy. But one of the things about this guy, one of the things that he's doing is that it was kind of a big deal, a heady kind of thing to follow a famous rabbi. And so here he is. He sees that Jesus is the rising star there in Israel. And so he wants to hitch his wagon to it early on. And so that he can go around and say, I am a disciple of this great and famous miracle worker and rabbi. And you notice as he says, teacher, I'll follow you wherever you go. You know, it doesn't matter wherever you go. You know, I'll stay with you through thick and thin. And Jesus said to him, foxes have holes to sleep in, birds of the air have nests to sleep in, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. It appears that this first man, this scribe, is having an emotional experience at the moment. And he's looking at all these things that Jesus is doing, he's listening to all these things, and he's just out of emotion, he's saying, listen, I'm going to follow you wherever you go. And Jesus pulls him up and really gets his attention. I mean, again, nobody talked to the scribes this way. And Jesus said, listen, you better think this over. It's not easy to follow me. There's more to it. You will, he's saying this, you'll never ever last following me on the basis of an emotional decision. You better count the cost. And then when you count the cost, then you can follow me. And I don't think there's enough speaking on that particular subject. There's a lot of mood music to try and move people emotionally, come to know the Lord, and they got the organ going in the background, the different things, and a few sad stories, getting everybody crying and all of this kind of thing, and talk about a few train wrecks and this kind of stuff. And those things are okay when they're just being used in a straightforward kind of way. But when they're used in order to produce an emotional kind of decision in people, Jesus isn't interested in that. Because he knows it won't last. It won't last through the night. It certainly won't last a week. Not in following him. It is the greatest life in the world to follow Jesus. But it is not the easiest life in this world. And Jesus said, you need to count the cost as it relates to that. And then he leaves the man. We have no idea what the man's decision was related to that. But I think it's good. And it's good just to, tell people, listen, you ought to think that through. Think about what he's calling to you to. Are you willing to deny yourself, take up the cross and follow after him? And then not to make that decision until I'm willing to do that. And so Jesus kind of pushes him back a little bit, makes him think. And then there was another of his disciples that was following him here in the crowd. And he said to Jesus, Lord, let me first go and bury my father. But Jesus said to him, follow me and let the dead bury their own dead. You remember the first time you read that? Maybe some of you are reading it for the first time. You think, whoa, what is Jesus saying? The guy can't even take 2 days to attend his father's funeral, you know? And I mean, is that the kind of, is Jesus that hard? What the man is asking for is he's asking Jesus, I want to follow you, but I want to wait until my father dies. His father could live for another 50 years. Then I'll follow you. And Jesus is saying, listen, let the dead bury their dead. Let the spiritually dead bury the physically dead. You are needed in what God is doing in this world, and you need to do what the spiritually dead can't do. And that's what we're called to do. We work, we have jobs, we do all these things, but it's spiritual activity that we're doing to the Lord, where God has put us, in our neighborhoods and all, mothers, all of these things and all. But there are things in this world that only we can do. That the people that don't know the Lord, they can't do those things. And so if we spend our lives living them like everyone else in the world is living them, we're living like the dead. We're wasting our lives. Jesus has something higher for us than that. And so he said, listen, you follow me and let the dead bury the dead. It's probably very likely that what this man was concerned about was he wanted his family's blessing upon following the Lord. And he knew that his father wouldn't give him a blessing to leave the family, to leave the family business or to leave whatever, and then to follow Jesus. He wouldn't get the family blessing. So he's saying, listen, I can't leave my family with their blessing. And so I'm asking you to wait until I'm the head of the family, and then I can make that decision. And so, I mean, how many of us would be Christians today if it depended on our family's blessing? Was their worst nightmare that some of us would come to know the Lord, let alone to serve the Lord. But Karen and I got saved, and then here we are, we're moving over here. I mean, you couldn't hear the end of it. There were some people who were supportive, but I mean, no one who didn't know the Lord didn't think that was the stupidest thing in the world that you could do. And I wondered about it for really quite a length of time also. Myself, I was no giant of faith, believe me. And so here he is. He's wanting the family blessing, and you can't wait for the family blessing. Otherwise, we'll waste our whole lives waiting for that. I think there's also an element here where he was also concerned about his security, concerned about the family inheritance. He wanted to wait until his father died. He got his share of the inheritance, and then he could go ahead and make the decision. If he left now and followed the Lord, he would lose his inheritance. And people make that decision as it relates to following the Lord all the time, all over this world. And how many of us would be serving the Lord today if we waited until we were financially secure to begin to serve the Lord? None of us would be. because we live by faith. And so here he is. He comes. These are the concerns that he has. Jesus said, listen, you come and follow me and let the dead bury their own dead. And now in verse 23, when Jesus got into a boat, remember earlier, he had said, let's get in the boat and go to the other side. His disciples followed him into the boat. And suddenly a great tempest arose on the sea so that the boat was covered with waves. That's a boat I don't want to be on. This isn't just a wave, a storm. This is a storm so great that if you're on the shore looking at the boat, you're having trouble seeing it because it's covered by the waves. And so it was covered with the waves, but Jesus was asleep. And then his disciples came to him while he's sleeping down below deck, and they woke him up and they said, Lord, save us, where is he? And I make fun of them, but he has heard that from, not from my lips, I'm a little craftier than that, but it's been in my heart. And the Lord said to them, why are you fearful, O you of little faith? And then he arose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. And the men marveled, saying, who can this be that even the winds and the sea obey him? And so Jesus' authority over nature as he calms the sea. I think it's very important to understand and to recognize that when these guys were in that storm, they were smack dab in the middle of God's will. The great tendency for me is when I hit storms to think, show me where I'm supposed to go. Surely I've missed the communication. You wouldn't do this to me, you know, and all that kind of stuff. They were right in the middle of God's will, and there are storms in the middle of God's will. And we can't determine what God's will is based upon the storms of life, but upon his commands. He said, let's go to the other side. Let's get in that boat. They were in that boat only because he told them to get in the boat, and it was the only place they could be in order to follow him. But there are storms in life and following the Lord. And there's one thing to talk about storms in several verses on a page here in the Bible. And it's another thing to be in a storm that is covering your boat. These are fishermen. They're the pros. They knew the Sea of Galilee. The sea was their life. They knew storms. And yet here they hit a storm that undid them, that wiped them out, that brought them to the end of their resources, to where they came running to the Lord. And there are storms like that. They're just like that. They just overwhelm. You can't even believe that such a storm could even exist. And they come in our area of expertise so often, so that we don't trust in our experience and all of our great wisdom and all of that, but we learn to trust in the promises of God and in the Word of God. And so here they are in this place, this terrible, difficult storm that they were in, and yet Jesus said, let's go to the other side. And since Jesus said, let's go to the other side, they were going to get to the other side. Now, some of you have walked with the Lord for a long time. You've heard 20 sermons on this whole incident. That when Jesus says we're going to the other side, he's going to get us to the other side. I mean, the preacher opens his mouth, he reads the text, and you go, all right, I know everything he's going to say from here. I mean, it's not easy being a preacher. I'm telling you, you ought to smother me with things like that. But would you let it freshly impact your heart and your life tonight? Though you've heard it 1,000 times, though you've heard it 100 times, to just let that truth hit our lives fresh and anew. When God says we're going to the other side, we're going to get to the other side, no matter what the storms are. He's going to be faithful to his word. And his promises are yea and amen. I tell you, I am not any kind of old great saint or anything like that, but I will tell you, not one of his promises have failed in my life. It looked a little iffy for a while at times. And so it is in our lives. You're in that place tonight. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling, and he is going to present us before the Father with exceeding joy. That is in our future, every one of us. And every one of his promises are true to us while we get to that place. It's a beautiful truth. He's going to get us through because He's on board. He's on board. He's inside. He's inside of our lives. And they marveled at His authority over nature. And they said, who can this be that even the winds and the sea obey Him? And when He had come to the other side, to the country of the Gadarenes, which is also in the area, all of this is taking place up in the area of the Galilee, around the Sea of Galilee, there met Him two demon-possessed men. And here are men that are possessed and controlled by fallen angels. That's what a demon is. And so there are two of them. They're in the area of Gadara, coming out of the tombs. And if you go to Gadara today, there's this, there's this kind of a high area there, and there's just these holes all along these, in the cliffs and in the hill and all, and they would use any kind of cave for tombs in those days. And so here are these two men, they're living out in that area of the wilderness, some distance from Capernaum, and they came out of the tombs, they were exceedingly fierce, so that no one could pass that way. So they had a life of isolation, being demon-possessed. We're told in one of the other Gospels that they were chained, but they would break the chains. They were tormented in the condition they were in. And I think it's good to look in the Bible to see Satan's true colors when he gets a hold of a life. Sin's pleasurable for a season. It's exciting for a season. He has power. He gives power. He can be very alluring for a period of time and come as an angel of light for a period of time. But once He has control of a life, you watch what He produces. And here you have men that in essence, as you look in those days, it's the same way that we handle these kinds of people today. You isolate them or you incarcerate them. And I would add today that we medicate them. You have a spiritual realm that the natural man is unwilling to acknowledge. I had a loved one in my family that was in and out of state hospitals most of our childhood. And they take us in to visit her, and they take us behind one locked door after another, people locked up and drugged out of their minds back there. And I wondered, even as a kid, how many of these people are demon-possessed. They lock them up. They isolate them. This is the best that they can do. And what a need there would be for someone to go in and preach to them, for them to be delivered, you know. And these are things that only the Lord can take care of in a human life. But these people, man has no answer for this kind of situation, a demon-possessed person. And we're told in one of the other Gospels that focuses primarily on one of these two men, that he was possessed of a legion of demons. And a Roman legion was 6,000 soldiers. Can you imagine? Maybe this man possessed by 6,000 demons. I don't know where in the hopeless category you rate a guy like that. But the world has no answer for that man. Has no solution for him. Not at all. All of the world and all of man's thinking put together. They can preach all they want on mountaintops. They can write all of the columns that they want, write all of the lofty things they want, but they're powerless in the face of this. And so Jesus comes right into the middle of this whole scene, and as He does, suddenly these demon-possessed men, they cried out saying, "What have we to do with You, Jesus, You Son of God?" Interesting that the demons knew that He was the Son of God, and they knew He was divine. They acknowledge divinity. They're better theologians than the liberal theologians today. They understood more about God than the scribes and the Pharisees understood about God and about the Lord Jesus. And so they said, "What do we have to do with You, You Son of God? Have You come here to torment us before the time?" Now it's interesting that the demons understand that a day of torment is coming for them. And it's going to be a very long day of torment in eternity. And so here they're saying, "Have You come to, you know, deal with us before our time?" Now, a good way off from them, there was a herd of many swine feeding, pigs that were eating in the area. And so the demons begged Jesus. And I like this. Look at the authority that Jesus has. They don't just do whatever they want. They ask permission. And they begged him, saying, if you cast us out, permit us. Again, Jesus' authority over the demonic realm, over the entire spiritual realm. If you cast us out, permit us to go away into the herd of swine. It's fascinating concerning demons that they don't want to be independent of a body. They like to possess a body. I'm convinced that you look and you say, why in the world would they not just go into other human beings? Why wouldn't they just vacate here as Jesus forced them to vacate? Why would they be interested in going into pigs? And I think, and this may be personal opinion, so put down your pens. But I think for demon possession to occur, something has to occur in the life of the person that opens the door for it. Otherwise, they would just at random and effortlessly possess every single person that doesn't know the Lord, and that isn't a characteristic of the world. But you see, someone who opens up the door, begins to dabble there, begins to mess around, and immediately they're very happy to take possession of that life when a person yields their will to that power and wanting to be connected in that realm. And so apparently they didn't have any place else to go, and so rather than being, you know, disembodied altogether, they said, listen, why don't you let us go into that herd of swine? And they asked for permission. And Jesus said to them, go. And when they had come out, they went into the herd of swine. And suddenly the whole herd of pigs ran violently down the steep place into the sea, and they perished in the water. It is the first mention of deviled ham in the Bible. Okay, all right. You know, I try to liven things up for you, and this is what I get from you. It's an old gag, but I can never resist the deal. Interesting that the pigs would rather be dead than be demon-possessed. And you go to Gadara today, and around the Sea of Galilee, there's only one steep place all the way around the Sea of Galilee, and it's there in the region of Gadara. And you can see the spot to this day where they ran off of the edge and drowned there in the sea. Now, Jesus is probably killing two birds with one stone. We don't know that the people that owned the pigs were necessarily Jews, but most likely they were. And they had no business raising pigs. And so Jesus delivers these two men of the demons, and then he also wipes out an illegal industry that these Jews are involved in. He's very efficient. I don't know if you've noticed that in your own life. God, I'd like you to take care of this one area of my life. He says, yes, and I've got about six other things that I'll wipe out at the same time. You know, he's good at that. And so they go, they perished in the water, and then those who kept the pigs, they fled. They ran for their lives. They'd never seen anything like this. And they went into the city, and they told everything, including what had happened to the demon-possessed men. And behold, the whole city came out to meet Jesus, and they threw a parade, and they had a feast and everything, and everyone believed in the Lord. No, that's not what happened. That would have been the rational response. And when they saw him, they begged him. The demons begged, and now here they beg. They begged him to depart from their region, to leave, to leave. And to me, this is one of the most intense scenes in the Bible. And you know why it's intense to me? Because he leaves. He leaves. Jesus will never force himself on anyone. And thus I don't think we should force him on anyone. They didn't want anything to do with him, and so he left. I think that that is a heavy, heavy situation. And so the Lord, his authority over the entire demonic realm. It is interesting how easy it is for people to become more concerned about money than about human beings. They didn't come and rejoice over the fact that these two men who had been living a literal hell on earth had been delivered. All they cared about was the fact that their pigs were gone. And then they asked the Lord to leave.